Would you like to learn about agentic AI security? If so, this video is for you. Hi, my name is Mike Gibbs, and I am joined here by David Linthicum. David is an expert on AI and cloud architectures, and he's got an incredible amount of experience in the agentic AI world. If you don't know me, my background is network architecture, security architecture, and enterprise architecture, and I've got about 25 years background experience with this. David Linthicum is an expert, as I mentioned, in cloud computing and AI. He's also an instructor and the creator of our AI architect program. But today we're going to talk about something I'm pretty passionate about, which is security. I'm going to ask David to talk about agentic AI and security. But I am going to ask David to do one thing before he does that. I'm going to ask him to briefly remind everybody what is agentic AI in case you picked it up because you're one of our security audience fans and need a quick refresher on agentic AI. So David, could you talk about what is agentic AI rather rapidly?
Sure. I mean, the term agentic AI kind of really comes down to the ability to use agents. And of course, there's some discussion out there about AI agents versus agentic. And it really doesn't matter. At the end of the day, we're creating autonomous pieces of software that are able to either run together or run in a distributed way. And they're able to become intelligent so they can carry out goals and objectives. The way I like to explain it to my students, you can imagine you're starting a company and you're hiring individuals who will carry out particular functions. Well, those are agents. That's what agents do. They have a persona, they have a purpose, they have a direction, they have goals and objectives that they're hit moving to, and they're incentivized to move toward those goals and objectives. And they're able to operate independent of the other agents in a multi-agent configuration. So obviously it has some architectural advantages. I can run it closer to where the data is processed. I can put it on mobile devices. I can put it on my thermostat. They don't need specialized processors. Normally they're low powered things. They do carry the ability to have a model into themselves, normally a small language models. But also they can communicate with LLMs when they need to communicate with them. And obviously you can build an LLM within an agentic model. People are taking Llama and DeepSeek, which you can run on my Mac. I did it just to see, and incorporate it into an agent. So it has LLM capabilities, customized training, and the ability to have direct to task. And so the cool thing about that is it's able to run any number of places where you want it to run. It doesn't have to be this huge monolithic thing that runs on a centralized CPU with lots of GPU powers to make it happen, to cut the inference. So you can customize it for the exact needs of the application, exact needs of the architecture. And so people are, you know, leveraging that because they realize that obviously generative AI, certainly building LLMs to provide purpose-built solutions in a monolithic way, but the agentic stuff is a much more elegant, much more custom-fit solution, and we're able to accommodate exact needs of the application. That's why people are interested in it now. And also, LLMs are kind of out of the price tag of most enterprises out there. It costs $125 million to train and deploy an LLM. And obviously, DeepSeek can do it cheaper, but even they're looking at $10 million. It's still a lot of money. Agentic AI normally use very lower-end processing. They run on devices, things like that. And through the divide-and-conquer way of building these systems, you're in essence creating this very sophisticated system that's basically made up of many different agents that are carrying out particular tasks, that have their own knowledge models and able to carry out their own personas. So it's a very neat thing. It's not new. It's been around for a long time. We're building AI agents in the 90s. And agent technology has kind of come and go for a long period of time. I think it's being reincorporated with the generative AI stuff just because of the ability to leverage technology in a much more tactically focused, AI technology, much more tactically focused and customized way.
And thank you for that, David. And let's talk about how to secure that. And I'm not going into your traditional security, your network security, your IAM. I mean, those kinds of security architectures are pretty obvious. But there are unique needs of AI. And AI does have some unique security needs. And agentic AI is such. Could you talk about some of those needs and how we can protect against some of those things?
Yeah, you got to remember, we'll look at what agentic AI is and some of the challenges there. You know, it has multiple system entry points and many attack surfaces that are created by agents running all over the place. So we're not just securing a single monolithic thing where we have a knowledge model, access to data, and an inference engine. It could be typically running on the same processor clusters. So all we have to do is secure that domain, and we kind of got it. And you can, you know, use identity access managed encryption systems to do that. Security in the agentic AI world is a bit of a nightmare because you got things running all over the place on different platforms, and therefore the complexity itself is going to lead to a security challenge because you have to update all these things and update the encryption software and keep up with the maintenance of those systems. And if you're, you know, dealing with one monolithic system, it's not so bad. But if you're dealing with an agentic system that has 20, 30, you know, operating agents that are running all over the place, you have to keep up with those. So you have to have some sort of a centralized security manager to keep up with it. And the attack vectors and the attack surfaces are, you know, also a bit of a challenge. Now, instead of just one way or a couple ways to get into an AI system, you have as many agents as they have running, and you can attack those agents. They're a little bit more difficult to manage because we have to manage them through a distributed fashion, and they're not necessarily set up to defend themselves or be good at defending themselves. They're just set out to carry a task. So you have to have external security systems. Sometimes there's security agency build a part of it. So they're paired with the agent themselves. They're just carrying out the security aspect of it. If you're dealing with, you know, sensitive data, top secret data, things like that, you know, that's typically the best practice in doing it. But it's just going to be much more complex. It's just going to have more attack surfaces. You're going to have lots of other moving parts you're going to have to do, and your security solution is going to have to be as sophisticated as the agentic systems under themselves. And I think it's going to be a challenge for many people to do it. The times that I've carried it out, it always was a challenge, and always was a different bespoke security solution that we had to make it happen. And it's never going to be a best practice. It's always going to be customized for the particular agentic capabilities, the system, the platforms you're on, the databases you're using, things like that.
Yeah, I mean, the way these are laid out, it promotes a whole lot of vectors for problems to occur. Actually, truth be told, anytime you go distributed, it always adds a lot more challenges. Anytime you change the barriers from a hard perimeter to a soft perimeter, it changes things. But yeah, these are unique and specific to agentic AI. So, David, if you're a cloud architect or an AI architect, what pointers or things would you give them to think about when considering the additional security implications? Mapping out their workflows, for example, looking at the storage, looking at the databases, what kind of other suggestions would you provide?
Yeah, the big thing is look how agentic systems and the agents are going to share data. So that's the big one. So okay, information has to flow in and out of the agents, and that's where the vulnerability is going to occur. People were intercepted as it's consumed in and transmitted out. So you need to have some sort of a centralization of security systems that are able to manage those sorts of things. So people have a tendency when they see distributed, they go, okay, I have to have particular platform-specific security solutions or security silos for each of the platforms where the agents are running. And so if you have 25 agents running across 5 different platforms, they're going to have 5 different security solutions for it. Typically, that's going to be overly complex. Yeah. So your ability to manage complexity by putting volatility into a single domain and setting up a security system that's bespoke for the agentic system that you're doing is typically going to be the emerging best practice. And so you kind of have to think differently when you do it. People have a tendency when they look at distributed systems, and I know you know this, Mike, they want to attack them as to where they exist. And if you're dealing with different, multi-processing systems and distributed databases, things like that, they want to protect them within the particular platform. That's never a good idea. Obviously, no. You have to deal with the platform characteristics. But, you know, when you're looking at this, it should be a centralization of the system. It should always be putting volatility into a single domain, your ability to deal with security through a configuration platform. Look at identity access management, because obviously the agents can carry an identity, and even the services the agents provide can carry an identity. You know, understand the vulnerabilities are going to be a bit different. We do have AI poisoning, which is still going to be an attack vector where they can get into the particular small language model or large language model of the agent and interject some logic that, you know, causes fun stuff like transferring $10,000 a day to someone's account. That's actually a real life scenario that I ran into in my career. And just in doing that, therefore, you have to put in the protections in your in AI, just like any other AI system. So you have to deal with model poisoning. You have to deal with model maintenance. You have to deal with updating the software to make sure that the vulnerabilities are going to be corrected. And so basically everything you have to do in building an AI system, but multiply times the number of agents that you have or the number of platforms that you're there. The way I like to say, you're dealing with more complexity. You're dealing with more moving parts. You're dealing with more vulnerabilities. You're dealing with more attack vectors. And that doesn't mean you shouldn't move to agentic. Those are all manageable problems, but you just have to consider them as the challenge, and you put them in your security plan and how you roll the stuff out.
Yeah, and I think I want to highlight on one thing. You talked about using common and centralized security. That's going to be critical. We don't want five security platforms. Now, there's a couple of reasons. Let's say we're hosted in five clouds. The cloud providers do have security solutions. They do. And like a Swiss Army knife, they do a lot of things. But they typically lack in some of the behavioral-based detection of things and attacks that have never been seen before, compared to more enterprise solutions like a Palo Alto or a Checkpoint or a Fortinet, which is okay, because that's all they do is just this, where cloud providers do so many great things. So it's a lack of focus. But if I've got one or two sets of tools and I can manage them centrally and have the same set of tools, now I've got one set of vulnerabilities to manage in the technology platforms. I've got one set of weaknesses and I know what their strengths are. And I can use one or two platforms that support each other as opposed to having five different systems, all with different strengths and weaknesses. And I have no idea where my attack vectors are going to be coming from. And how am I even going to manage that complexity? So totally agree with you.
Yeah, it's a big consideration. And it's funny, we kind of learned lots of lessons, you know, back in the 90s in terms of people moving in distributed systems and the complexity in dealing with that. And obviously the security tools we have today and the encryption models and the and identity access management wasn't even a thing then, are available to us. And so moving into these environments, people have a tendency to want to solve the security issues at the point where the applications exist. We saw the same thing in multi-cloud. Yep. You know, show me a multi-cloud system, and if I count seven clouds, I can count a minimum of seven security solutions that are there. Yep. And obviously seven skill sets around the organization that are, are able to maintain those systems, and that just won't scale. It just won't work. So you have to think differently in terms of how you approach the problem and think centrally in a way where we're going to be able to put things that change in a particular configurable domain. So in other words, as we secure all these various agents, we have things and software that run on the platforms, but those things are centrally controlled. So the idea that we're going to have a separate security system for every platform, which is normally the way, you know, they see these things architected, is going to cost you three times to five times as much for the security solution. It's not going to be as good. There's going to be vulnerabilities in it. And I've audited those things. You can spot them fairly quick. And it's going to be overly complex to maintain it. So if we have a security solution, that's well and good. But if it takes us five times the money and five times the people to maintain it, because we have a huge heterogeneity in terms of how we're dealing with security, we haven't solved the problem. Now, the argument sometimes comes back to me where we can use the best of breed security on that particular platform. Yeah, all well and good. And I understand why people want to do that. But if there is no centralization of control and centralization of configuration, then that's not necessarily going to be able to scale. So agentic obviously is going to be adding agents, deleting agents, and even having agents that are able to replicate themselves. And you know, I built a system one time where the agents were able to move from platform to platform, you know, as they need to do that. And obviously that's a security nightmare, but it can be configured. It can be managed if you do so in a centralized way. And that blows people's minds somehow, because we were taught to, you know, do things in absolutely the best practice on the particular platforms they're on, build firewalls everywhere, all that kind of stuff, custom encryption systems, won't work. And so you have to think differently when you deal with agentic.
And everything like that, as soon as it gets too complicated, too many proprietary systems, one or two that are real good, that we know with great companies that provide great support, that we've got lots of knowledge on, it's just so much simpler. And I can tell you the first network I worked on, they decided they were going to make it the fastest network in the world. I can just remember it. It was in the days where it was the first AI-based trading system in the world. And they had about 15 different companies, routers and switches based on each one that could do the one thing the fastest. And I remember looking at the first time and I said, how often does this break? And they said, every day, Mike. That's why we hired you. And I'm like, okay, so let's figure out what we really need. Let's figure a way out a way to really simplify this thing. And then it worked. So yeah, sample, elegant, a couple of set of tools, not a thousand tools, and then middleware to talk in between tools. And then another set of vulnerabilities that we introduced. I'm totally with you. David, I want to thank you for sharing your expertise. I know you've been working in AI since the late 80s and have a lot of experience here. And I really appreciate you sharing that expertise with our audience. If you've enjoyed this video, maybe give it a like, subscribe to our channel and hit the bell to be notified of new videos. If you want to learn how to become an architect, either an AI architect, join David and I on a webinar. They're free. They'll be on Zoom. We can talk about what we do, the skills you need, how to get hired and the such. Or you can join me on a cloud architect webinar. Sometimes you'll see David too. An enterprise architect webinar, a security architect webinar, a network architect webinar. I just love all the IT architect jobs and I want you all to get architect hired. Thank you so much, David. And we'll see you all in a new video. Take care, everyone.
Thank you.